All right, kids, you are free to head to the clubhouse and the loft. And yeah, all right, go. Yeah. All right, head on. And let's pray for them as they go. Dear Lord, we thank you for the energy of these young people as they head out to learn more about you and about your great love for them. Help their leaders to serve them well and to help them see Jesus this day. Help us see Jesus today as well, and help us be open to your Holy Spirit speaking into us. God, I pray for each person here to hear exactly what it is you need them to hear, regardless of the words that come out of my mouth, and help me get out of the way so you can come and truly be the way, the truth, and the life in the lives of those who are gathered here on this day. In Jesus' name, amen. So what do you suppose was the most significant 24-hour period in human history, the one that changed things the most? I looked up on a kind of a conversation site to see what other people thought might be the most important day in human history. One person suggested the Cuban Missile Crisis of 1961, that was the day that turned back the nuclear annihilation of the world, and so that was a really significant day. That one wouldn't win the day for me. Somebody suggested the day that Gutenberg created and put his final touches on the invention of the printing press. Obviously, being able to put words in print was pretty huge. Somebody suggested July 16th, 1945. Who knows what that was? The first atomic bomb test, Trinity test. Somebody suggested 9/11, 2001. And while that was clearly an incredibly significant day in the life of our country, I don't know that I'd put that as the top day in human history. An interesting suggestion was Washington crossing the Delaware, because without him crossing the Delaware, the likelihood is that the American Revolution would have been lost, which would have changed human history in significant ways. One person lifted up the invention by Dr. Ignaz Semmelweis. How many of you know Ignaz? No? He created, I know this sounds silly, but he created hand washing in the 1840s. He was a French doctor who realized that death through childbirth would become drastically lower if doctors would just wash their hands. But you know what? Nobody listened to him. It wasn't until after he died, abjectly poverty-stricken, that his invention of hand washing had been received. Now, that's a powerful and incredible invention. I'm glad that he invented hand washing, but I wouldn't make that the number one most significant day. Somebody said, how about the day when someone finally said, you know what, I'm tired of hunting and gathering, and I'm going to start farming 10,000 years ago. That was a big day. Or the Industrial Revolution of the 1760s. Of course, that wasn't really a day. That kind of happened over a period of time. Or how about Adam and Eve's fateful decision to eat from the tree of good and evil? I'd say that was a pretty significant day. Or even before that, the day when God said, you know what? Let me speak the universe into existence. Pretty significant day, right? What would you say that the most significant 24-hour period, not only in human history, would be that changed the world the most, but also changed your life the most? Well, Jesus lived on this earth for only 33 years. Now, I remember when 33 seemed really old. When I was 10, I longed to be 30 because I just knew that 30-year-olds had it all together and had everything figured out. How's that working for you, 30-year-olds? You got it? And the interesting thing, too, is, you know the phrase, don't trust anyone over 30? The guy who said that is still alive. He's 83, okay? But 33 years equals just 12,000 days. And, of course, the gospel writers focused mostly on just the 3-year period of Jesus' active ministry. And most of that they focused on was like Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John spent most of their time focused on this 24-hour period in human history, as Jesus made the journey to the cross, to his suffering and his death. And so, in light of Easter and the resurrection, I'm going to say that the day that changed the world the most was this 24-hour period before the cross and including the cross. Hopefully, that's true for you and me as well along the way. So in this season of Lent, which is designed to prepare us for the resurrection and Easter Sunday, over the next Sundays, we're going to be looking at this last 24-hour period, this last day in the life of Jesus, to kind of look at his suffering and his death that was for each one of us, just taking a day in the life of the one that we call Savior and Lord, and what an incredible difference that makes on our journey of life. And so we're going to begin today with the most significant meal on the most significant day in human history. Now, I don't know about you, but I really like to eat. I like to eat when I'm really happy. I like to eat when I'm sad. I like to eat when I'm not feeling anything at all. I have never forgotten to eat a meal any time in my life. And I know that in the season of Lent, we mainly focus on what we fast from, what we let go of. But I'm always encouraged by the fact that Jesus, a lot of his ministry happened around meals. And he really, they mattered. Meals mattered a great deal to him as we kind of look through the New Testament. I mean, Jesus fed crowds on a number of occasions, taking just small amounts of fish and bread and turning it into a miracle and feeding thousands of people. I love that when in the Luke 15, in the story of the prodigal son, when the son comes to his senses and returns home to his father, the first thing that the father does isn't scold his son, but immediately kills the fatted calf and said, "We must celebrate my son who was lost and is now found." A celebratory meal in that moment. Or Jesus, the way he would eat a meal with anyone at any time to simply show them God's great love for them. Jesus also, he didn't hesitate to invite himself to people's meals. He just showed up sometime and said, "Hey, I'm here. Let's eat." One time in Luke 19, he looked up into a tree and there was Zacchaeus, and he says, "Hey, you got to come down from there. I'm going to eat with you today." And Zacchaeus didn't say, "I'm not prepared to have you come over to my place." And he welcomed him in and they had a meal together. Well, think about on the road to Emmaus when in Luke 24, when Jesus is talking with these strangers. They're actually followers of his, but they don't recognize Jesus. Do you remember how they recognize him? When they ate bread together, when it says when they broke bread together, their eyes were open and they saw Jesus. Meals mattered a lot to Jesus. There's the occasion when Mary and Martha was preparing a meal for him in Luke chapter 10, and she was anxious about many things, the scripture says. Now, Jesus very gently and with a great deal of love kind of says to her gently, "Mary, Mary, Martha, Martha, you are anxious about many things, but Mary has done what is good and right." And Mary, what was Mary doing? She was sitting at his feet, soaking and learning in his love. And he basically was saying to Martha, the meal preparation is good and important, but don't forget to sit at my feet and soak in my love. That's important too. Or how about the occasion when, so Peter had obviously, he had denied even knowing Jesus several times, and he felt like he had betrayed Jesus just as much as Judas had in many ways, and he wasn't sure what to do, and so he went fishing. He didn't know what else to do. In John 21, Jesus encounters him and says, "I want you to feed my sheep. I want you to feed my sheep. I want you to feed my lambs. I want you to tend my people." And he restores Peter. But what Jesus is doing on the beach when they encounter him is he's busy cooking fish. He's preparing a meal for his disciples, and they're going to eat together as friends. But Jesus lifts up one meal in the scriptures above all other meals, and it's a meal that he's been eating his entire life, but he gives completely new meaning to. It's the Passover meal. And meals matter to Jesus, and so they matter to us. And Jesus told his followers then long ago and in every generation since, "I want you to eat this meal in remembrance of me and my great love for you. I want you to acknowledge that I have a great love for you and that you are receiving me. And that by simply drinking some bread and drinking some juice in my honor, it will be to your benefit, to my glory as well." And so in his very last supper, Jesus chose to gather with his disciples, his closest friends, for this last supper, this last meal. And he transforms it in an incredible way. Find the story in many of the Gospels, but in Mark chapter 14, verses 12 through 25 is where we'll be today. And it says, on the first day of the festival of unleavened bread, when the Passover lamb is sacrificed, Jesus' disciples asked him, where do you want us to go to prepare the Passover meal for you? So in this moment, the disciples are acknowledging in this moment that Jesus is the one who is the host of this meal. So it's his responsibility to take care of the details. And the disciples are saying, and we'll do that for you, Jesus. How can we help you in this moment? And how can we help you with this meal? Now, this is an incredibly confusing time for the followers of Jesus. They're wondering, what does it mean for Jesus to lay claim to be the one who is bringing in the very kingdom of God? What does it mean that Jesus is he going to come in and destroy the earthly power, the oppressive power of the Roman government? Is Jesus going to be the one who comes in as an earthly Messiah and changes everything for us? For just days earlier, he had entered into Jerusalem like a king would enter in victory with great shouts of joy and hallelujah. But that's over. The mood has shifted very quickly. And now things are very somber. Verse 13. So Jesus sent two of them into Jerusalem with these instructions. As you go into the city, a man carrying a pitcher of water will meet you. Follow him. Now, I want to submit to you that this man would not have been particularly hard to spot. Why? Because 2,000 years ago, carrying a pitcher downtown was not a man's job. Women were the ones who carried pitchers. And so this was either a miracle or Jesus made a prearranged moment. But either way, it's significant because it shows that God is at work. If it was a miracle, clearly God was at work. If it was prearranged, that doesn't take anything away. Why? Because it reveals the reality that God works through our planning. When we say to God, lead us, guide us, direct us, help us on the journey, and we submit ourselves fully to him, and then we say, now, God, help me plan what is next, okay? Then that is a good thing, and God works through that as well. Verse 14, at the house he enters, say to the owner, the teacher asks, where is the guest room where I can eat the Passover meal with my disciples? He will take you upstairs to the large room that is already set up, and that is where you should prepare our meal. So the disciples asked this unnamed, clearly wealthy person for a room to have the Last Supper in. This is an unnamed man who makes a contribution. And that reminds us that we can make contributions in all kinds of ways as well. Lots of different ways to do that as Christ followers, even behind the scenes. But this man, who we'll never know the name of, served the Lord this day. Verse 16. So the two disciples, who we know from other Gospels were Peter and John, went into the city and found everything just as Jesus had said, and they prepared the Passover meal there. Now, that's kind of a little throwaway line. It's kind of nonchalant, as if it was no big deal. Preparing the Passover meal was huge. It was complicated. It was a big deal. So Peter and John had to take a lamb to the temple, have it ritually sacrificed by the priests that were there, and then they had to obviously cook it for several hours. They had to gather all the other food to make up the meal that would be for the Passover, for his 12 closest friends. Now, Peter and John couldn't have imagined how significant it was that Jesus left this responsibility in their hands in this moment. Now, they might have grumbled about it in that day, but I suppose they'd be honored by it later, because it's the beginning of a new, powerful ritual meal for followers of Jesus. Verse 17, in the evening, Jesus arrived with the 12 disciples. Now, the Gospels differ in some ways in terms of the way they tell the story of how Holy Communion comes to be. I always love the differences in John's gospel. In John chapter 13, we find on that night before Jesus went to the cross, the story of Jesus washing the disciples' feet in preparation for the Passover meal. Now, it's an important detail that Jesus, the host, was responsible for taking care of, and he left it out of his planning. Now, did he do that on purpose? I suspect he did, because he wanted to see how the disciples would handle the reality that he wasn't taking care of, that normally the host would assign a servant to come and wash all the disciples' feet. Well, Jesus didn't do that. Now, in the Holy Land, it is dry and dusty, and when you've been wandering around in sandals all day, your feet are pretty filthy, and before you sit down to eat, you need to have your feet washed because they're going to be sticking up in other people's face. We'll see that in a little while. But it's the host's job to make provision for the foot washing. But Jesus didn't attend to that detail. Now, the disciples, they'd just been arguing over who was the greatest among them in the kingdom of heaven. And in an incredible act of humble holiness, they were arguing over this matter. And so I think Jesus said, you know what? There's an opportunity here for me to have a teaching moment, even in this, my last 24 hours of life. So everyone's still there. They're gathered together. And Jesus is the last to arrive. And none of them are ready to eat the meal because none of them have clean feet. This is important. So Jesus, I want you to think about this. In the last day of his life, Jesus is still busy teaching and leading his disciples, his 12 closest friends and followers, how to do life. Now, since they weren't ready to eat, why is that important? Well, let's say this is the most famous picture of the Lord's Supper. This is from Leonardo da Vinci, and this is a great work of art, and it shows us a lot about how to understand this Last Supper, but it's also wrong, okay, because that's not how they would have been sitting. This is the table they would have been at in ancient world was a triclinium, and you notice that there are no chairs there. They're reclining. So that's why there would have been feet in your face for the meal. It was really important not to have that happen, especially at the most important meal of the year as they were reenacting the Passover, the single most important experience to give thanks for and remember for the Jews. It represented their identity as a people from slavery out of Egypt into the Promised Land. So not only had none of the disciples voluntarily taken up the towel and washed other disciples' feet, no one had also bothered to say, you know what, I'll at least go and individually wash my own feet. I'll take responsibility for myself. So they're all still filthy there with their feet. They're not ready to meet Jesus in the meal. It is so important for us to be ready to meet Jesus in this holy meal. And they weren't that day. But Jesus, in his humble holiness, chose to take up the towel and wash the disciples' feet as an act of service. And he models that act of service for them, and he models that act of service for us 2,000 plus years later. Now, here's the thing. He knew that none of them would fare very well over the next 24-hour period, that they would wind up hiding behind closed doors and frightened in fear before the resurrection. Maybe he washed their feet precisely because he knew they would not fare very well over the next time frame. The reality is that it's important for us. And Jesus said, you know what? These are the people that I want to enjoy my last meal with on this day, this most important meal on this most important day with these people. If you knew you were going to have your Last Supper, who would you share that meal with? Who would be the people sitting around the table with you? Who would it be important for you to say, let's gather together one last time? Well, Jesus needed to be with these, his closest friends, not so that he'd have strength for the cross, but so that he could strengthen them for what he knew was waiting ahead of them, so that they could be strengthened for the journey. And the one who was pouring into them in this moment was going to be poured out for you and for me and for them in less than 24 hours. Verse 18, as they were at the table eating, well, what were they busy eating? Well, the meal was a dramatic remembrance of Exodus chapter 3 through 13, when God delivered the Israelites from slavery in Egypt. The Pharaoh had refused to let his people go time after time after time. They'd been given 9 plagues, 9 serious warnings, each one successively worse. And finally, the worst one came, the last straw, the 10th plague. It was that the firstborn son of the Egyptians would die. Now, they'd had time and time and time again to relent and let the people go. But God told the people of God, the Israelites, said, I want you to take a sacrificed lamb and put the blood over the doorpost so the angel of death will pass over your home. And they were told by God to have one final meal before they hit the road for the promised land. And they were told to have unleavened bread. Well, why were they told to have unleavened bread? Well, it was because they were in a hurry, because there was a deep sense of urgency. They didn't have time to let the bread rise. They were on the move. They were on the go really quickly. There were bitter herbs like horseradish there, and there were salt water present to represent their tears from their suffering that they had gone through for so many years. There was cheroset, which is a pureed apples together, and that symbolized the mortar for the oppressive buildings that Pharaoh had put the people to build. There was an egg that was a symbol of new life. There was, of course, obviously the lamb shank that was clearly representative of the Passover, right? There were 4 cups of wine. We see the 4 cups of wine in Exodus chapter 6, 6 through 8. First one says, I will free you from oppression. I will rescue you. The 3rd cup is, I will redeem you. And the 4th is, I will bring you into the promised land. All promises from God. Now, if you want to really experience these symbols in a much more powerful way than we can just talking about them, I really recommend this Passover, this Seder meal on March 24th in the evening, that Sunday evening there, that Pastor Chris and Anid, his wife, are putting on. And just make sure you sign up. Like I said, they'll fill up quickly, only 120 spots for that meal. Great way to experience this in a much deeper way. Going on with verse 18, it says, Jesus said, I tell you the truth, one of you eating with me here will betray me. I greatly, greatly distressed, each one asked in turn, am I the one? Now, I think it's a great thing the disciples, instead of pointing at one another and say, it must be you, okay? In an act of genuine humility, they say, am I the one? Is it me, Lord, who's getting ready to betray you? And it is a good question. It's an important question. Humble holiness asks, is it me, Lord? And it could be a question that we need to ask ourselves on a regular basis as we come to the table. Is it me, Lord? Because the truth is, all of the disciples of Jesus in this next 24-hour period are going to fail him in some significant ways. And they want to know, God, are you with me in this moment? Are you going to strengthen me for the moment? And they need that. But it's also powerful to me what happens here is that Jesus doesn't set Judas aside. Jesus has already washed Judas's feet. Jesus is going to serve Judas the bread and the wine. And go back to our triclinium picture here. That main seat there is the seat of honor, and the person that's in darkness, that's next to Jesus, who do you suppose that is? That's Judas. Why? Because he's right next to Jesus. And Judas is in the position of honor. He is in the position of the valued guest and is given extra dignity. And Jesus in this moment didn't say, Judas, you need to change seats. You need to get away from me. in the Lord, Last Supper here, in the Lord's Supper, we sit in the seat of honor next to Jesus. Picture Jesus sitting next to you, offering you the bread dipped in the juice. And you're in the seat where Judas was. And he doesn't say to you, you know what, Jamie, you need to change seats because you're too big of a mess. You need to get away from me. You're too big of a sinner. No, he instead offers us his very own self. In our need, in our betrayal, in our sin, in this moment, Jesus serves us. And in this moment, Jesus also models how we get to respond to people who betray and deny us. Jesus didn't push Judas away. He reached out in love and in grace. Now, so in John 21, Peter was restored by Jesus, the one who had denied him. He receives the forgiveness of Jesus, okay? Judas doesn't. But that doesn't mean that Jesus isn't offering it. In this moment of serving Judas, he's saying, this can be for you too, Judas. Now, we know that Judas says no, and he tragically takes his own life. But this reminds me that I am a sinner saved by grace through faith in Jesus Christ alone, that I am welcome at the table that Jesus is the host of, and that I had better be careful not to deny this table to anyone else who wants to get access to the host, to the one who has grace and offers new life. Verse 20. He replied, "It is one of you 12 who is eating from this bowl with me. For the Son of Man must die, as the scriptures declared long ago, but how terrible it will be for the one who betrays me. It would be far better for that man if he had never been born." Now then, at this most important meal, on this most important day in human history, Jesus threw the disciples an unexpected curve, and he changed the words of Passover. So he changed the meaning of what this ritual actually has to do. Verse 22, he says, as they were eating, Jesus took some bread. He blessed it. He broke it in pieces and gave it to his disciples and said, take, eat. This is my body. I want you to imagine the very first time those disciples in that room with Jesus, and they're hearing these words. These words have never been spoken before. They're brand new. Jesus is transforming what this all means. And then he says, and he took a cup of wine and gave thanks to God for it. He gave it to them and they drank from it all. And he said to them, this is my blood, which confirms the covenant between God and his people. It is poured out as a sacrifice for many, for many. I tell you the truth, I will not drink wine again until the day I drink it in the new kingdom. And the cup that he lifted up would have been the third cup, the cup of what? Redemption, right? Redemption. And then he says, I look forward to the heavenly banquet feast that God the Father has in store for us. This is my body, he says. This is my blood. And he moves from this powerful symbol, but it's just a symbol, of sacrificial lambs to literally being the lamb that is sacrificed who takes away the sin of the world. God's very own son for us. And Jesus becomes the Passover lamb for you and for me and for the world. And we pass over from slavery to freedom. We pass over from death to new life. And the Lord's Supper becomes a defining moment for us as much as Passover is a defining moment for Jews. And Jesus paid the price for our redemption. It's as if we were in that very room on that night long ago, and Jesus said, do this in remembrance of me. And in the Lord's Supper, we reflect deeply on the meaning of Christ's life, on the meaning of Christ's death, on the meaning of his resurrection, on his coming and final victory. We reflect on our own life in Christ. We reflect on who he is. We reflect on what it means that we receive this with one another as we look around the room at our brothers and sisters in Christ. And every time we receive it, we also can consider all the Christ followers around the world, many of whom are persecuted, and thinking they are with us in this moment as well, as we receive the body and the blood of Jesus Christ in remembrance of him. And this holy meal points us back to that upper room long ago. It points us to what God is up to right now in our life and in our life together as the church. It points us to that future when we will enjoy that heavenly feast with Jesus in all of its fullness. We celebrate that we move from slavery to freedom, from selfishness to joyful service, and from death to new life. Friends, this is the body of Christ, which has been broken for you. Take and eat the body of Christ. This is the blood of Christ that has been shed for you. Take and open it if you can. And receive it with great joy. Let's pray. Dear God, we thank you for who you are. We thank you for this most incredible meal on this most incredible day, that you would give yourself for us, that you would transform this Passover meal and give it new life for us, that we might be open to receiving more of your love into our one and only lives. Help us, Lord. Help us, Lord, to fully receive you in this holy meal. We love you and thank you. In the strong name of Jesus, we all agreed and said, amen. Let's stand together and